Thanks, Meg. So if you have your Bibles, turn to the Gospel of Mark, and we're going to read chapter 1 and verse 9 to 13. Those who weren't here last week, I mentioned that we are starting a new series through the Gospel of Mark entitled, What Would Jesus Do?, focusing on the person and the life of Jesus. And I shared last week that whenever I'm struggling with my doctrine and my theology and trying to figure out how to live, I've just learned the secret is to go back to Jesus and look what Jesus did. Look how he lived. Look how he worked out his journey with his Father. And so that's what we're going to be doing over the next couple of months, just working through the Gospel of Mark and looking at the life of Jesus. The title of my message this morning is simply Jesus' Identity. Identity. Let's read God's word this morning. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." At once the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days being tempted by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and the angels attended him. As we journey with Jesus through the Gospel of Mark, and as we journey with Jesus in his life, I notice in our passage this morning that there were two key things that established Jesus right at the beginning of his journey with Father God in his 3 years of ministry on earth. Two significant things. Firstly, he was baptized with the Holy Spirit. God's Holy Spirit came upon him, and Jesus ministered from the place of being empowered by God's Holy Spirit for the next 3 years. Prior to that, he couldn't do any miracles. He couldn't do what God had called him to do, but God's Spirit came. That was part of his foundation. The other part of his foundation was right at the beginning of his ministry, Jesus discovered who he truly was. Who he was and whose he was. Jesus lived and ministered from a place of a secure identity. There was no question in his mind who he was and whose he was. And therefore, he was able to live his life as an open book. He was able to be real and authentic. He was able to be vulnerable. He was not threatened by those around him. He never ever sought to prove himself. He never sought to live up to the expectations and the requirements of those around him, because Jesus knew who he was. He knew why he was here. And he was not concerned about those around him. Jesus lived from a place of a secure identity. You know, today it's so difficult when you relate to someone who lives and leads from a place of a broken identity. The problem with a broken identity is that you are constantly trying to prove yourself. And in trying to prove yourself, you need to put others down in order that you would lift yourself up. And so often we experience, even in the world today, national leaders who live from a place of a broken identity, and everyone else suffers because of that. Friends, this morning, Jesus' heart and Father's heart for you this morning is that you and I would live from the same place that Jesus lived from, empowered by the Holy Spirit, but from a place of a secure identity, knowing who we are and knowing whose we are. Just three lessons I want to share with you this morning from our passage. The first one is this: Jesus' identity confirmed. Jesus' identity confirmed. Take a look at verses 9 through to 11. Jesus comes to the river Jordan. He's baptized by John the Baptist in the river. And as he comes out of the water, we are told that a loud voice spoke from heaven, proclaiming in Matthew 3 and verse 17, we read, "This is my Son whom I love. With him I am well pleased." We know that Jesus was fully God and fully man. But when he came to earth, he gave up his divinity and he operated as and he lived as a man like you and I. And therefore he was able to die like a man in order to pay for your sin and mine. And Father God knew that as Jesus lived as a man and as Jesus ministered as a man, Father God knew that right at the beginning, Jesus needed to know who he was. Jesus needed a secure identity. And Father God, knowing this, as Jesus comes up out of the water, Father God baptizes him in the Holy Spirit. And then what does Father God do? He establishes his identity. Notice he says three things to Jesus on that occasion. He says, firstly, "This is my Son." And he establishes Jesus as the Son of God. He establishes his role as the Savior, the promised Messiah who will come to save God's people. "This is my Son." And Jesus immediately knew who he was. But also he knew whose he was. Because as Father God says, "You are my Son," at the same time he's saying, "I am your Father." And Jesus at that point knew that he would relate to God as his Father. Secondly, "whom I love." It establishes Jesus' worth and value in the eyes of the Father. Because we can have a father who is oppressive, a father who is cruel. But Father God comes and says, "Not only am I your Father, Jesus, but I am your beloved Father. Because I love you and I care for you." And thirdly, he says, "With him I am well pleased." And in doing that, he affirms the life that Jesus had already lived, a life of sinless perfection. And he comes to Jesus and he says to him, "Jesus, as you begin the next 3 years of your life, 3 years which would change the course of history, I come to you, and I want to say to you, as you come out of this river, you are my Son. I am your Father. I am well pleased with you, and I love you." You know, there are three profound questions that each one of us have to answer in our lives, and Jesus, as a man, needed to answer. And those three profound questions are simply this: who am I? Why am I here? And am I good enough? Who am I? Why am I here? And am I good enough? And Father God knew that. And in that statement, as Jesus comes out of the River Jordan, he answers all three of those questions. "You are my Son. You are here as the Son of God to save the world. And you are good enough because I love you. And I am well pleased with you." If you are a child of God, if you have accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you've been brought into the family of God and you are a son and a daughter of the living God. And Father God would speak by his Spirit into your heart and say, "You are my Son. You are my daughter. I have created you. I have saved you by the blood of Jesus. I love you and I am well pleased with you." What that does is it releases us into live as with an audience of one. There is only one that we need to please, and that is our loving Father. And so right at the beginning of his ministry, Jesus' identity is confirmed. But secondly, in the passage in verses 12 to 13, I see that Jesus' identity is challenged. You know, the amazing thing that when God speaks a truth into our lives, when God speaks the word and he speaks the truth, the devil will always, always seek to rob us of that blessing, and he will challenge the truth of God's word. When God said to Adam and Eve, "If you eat of the fruit of the tree of good and evil, you will die. And immediately Satan comes and he challenges and he says, did God really say, do you really think that this will happen? And notice what happens to Jesus. He hears God's voice, you are my son. And the Holy Spirit takes him into the desert to be tempted by Satan. And notice what happens. Take a look in Matthew chapter 4. Twice during that time, Satan challenges Jesus with the statement, if you are the Son of God, then bow down and worship me. If you are the Son of God. Jesus has just heard Father saying, you are my Son. And Satan is now questioning that and is saying, do you really believe that? And maybe you need to prove to me that you are the Son of God. And he challenges Jesus' identity. Throughout his ministry for the next 3 years, the Pharisees would come to him and they would reject the fact that he was the Messiah. And they would say to him, give us a sign. Prove to us that you are the Son of God. And Jesus refused. He said, I will not give you a sign. Because I do not need to prove who I am. I know I am the Son of God. And I know my Father loves me. And I know what my purpose is. And I do not need to prove it to you. What an amazing place to live from. Isn't that awesome? I think many of us suffer with the fear of man. And trying to live up to the expectations of man. But Jesus knew. He knew who his Father was. He knew who he was. And he lived from that place. And he refused to bow to the pressure of those around him. Even in the very last moment of his life. Jesus is about to die. He's about to give up his spirit. He's dying a cruel death on the cross. In that very moment in Matthew 27 and verse 40, the people cry out to Jesus, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God. Even in the moment of his greatest vulnerability, Satan is using God's people to question his identity. But a few minutes later, Jesus was able to say, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. In his last breath, he knew who he was. He knew whose he was. And he died in that reality, knowing that he was going to his Father. Man, isn't that awesome? If we could live every day in that reality. When we wake up, our first thought is, Father, you are my Father. I am your son. I am your daughter. And you are with me. But I want to say to you that every single day Satan is going to challenge your identity. Oh, so you say you're a son and daughter of God? Look what you've just done. Look at that sin that you've committed. You say you're a son of God, but you are struggling financially and you've got ill health and you've got a broken relationship. Surely you cannot be a son and a daughter of God because things would be going way better than what they are now. And again and again and again, the evil one will come and challenge our identity. We need to stand as Jesus stood. Not interested in what the evil one says. Not interested in what others say about us. But only in what our Heavenly Father says about us. And when we are born again by the blood of Jesus, we are adopted into the family of God. We become sons and daughters of the living God, co-heirs with Jesus, and that's who Father God sees us to be. We live in the reality that the God of the universe is our Father, and we seek to please Him alone. So Jesus' identity was challenged. But then thirdly, we see Jesus' identity manifested. Jesus had his identity confirmed by the Father. Jesus withstood the temptation in the desert to give up his identity and to worship the evil one. He passed the test, but how does this now manifest in his life? Jesus knew who he was, but more importantly, he knew whose he was. You see, for the Jews, their picture of God was a God who was distant, a God who was awesome, a God who was to be feared, a God who was someone who you drew close, you wanted to draw close to, but you didn't want to get too close. That was the picture of God for the Jews. But Jesus comes, and every time he relates to God, he relates to God as Father. Why? Because God had come to him at the Jordan and said, I am your Father and you are my Son. And every time Jesus relates to God, he relates as Father. We see this demonstrated in two of the most profound prayers Jesus utters in Scripture. Firstly, the Lord's Prayer in Matthew 6 verse 9, and then the high priestly prayer in John chapter 17. The disciples come to Jesus and say, Lord, we've seen you praying. We are amazed at what is going on. Teach us to pray. And in the Lord's Prayer, we know so well, Jesus teaches them to pray, and there's so much in that prayer. But I believe one of the critical aspects of that prayer is right at the beginning when Jesus said, as you pray, pray our Father. Because the key thing with prayer is all about who we are praying to. It's not so much what we are praying, but who we are praying to. And Jesus, in teaching them that, is saying, as you pray, know that you are not praying to a fearful, distant God, but you are praying to a loving Father. And that should influence the attitude with which you come and pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. And then he goes on and he teaches the rest of that prayer. But what is very interesting, in the very next chapter, in Matthew chapter 7, from verse 9 through to 11, he has just taught them how to pray. Then what does he do? He continues in Matthew 7 and he says, which of you, if your son asks you for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a snake? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? You see what Jesus is doing? He's given them the Lord's Prayer. He's told them, pray our Father. And then he reinforces the relationship between a son and a father. And he says, if your son asks for bread, you're going to give him bread. Even though you are evil, how much more will your loving Father give to you all that you need? Therefore, when you come in prayer, come boldly. Come boldly to a Father who loves you and who desires to meet your deepest need. And so every time Jesus relates to God, he relates to Father. How do you relate to God? Sadly, many of our images of Father God are distorted because of the earthly fathers that we've had, and that's a tragedy. And maybe you need to be asking Father God to redeem your picture of him as a loving Father, one that we can come boldly towards and ask generously for what we need. But for me, the greatest expression of Jesus' relationship with Father God was to be found in the ultimate crisis of his life, the moment of absolute desperation. Jesus fell back at a deeper, deeper level to the reality that his God was his Father. And I speak about that time in the Garden of Gethsemane. He knows the physical pain, the spiritual separation and the shame that he was about to go through. And as he sweats great drops of blood praying in the Garden of Gethsemane, in Mark 14 verse 36, Jesus cries out, not just Father, But he uses for the very first time a different name for Father. And he cries out, Abba! And the word Abba is a way more personal and intimate word to express Father. It's that deep, deep reaching into the loving Father. Daddy, Papa, Abba. You see, in his greatest need, Jesus knew that he needed to draw near to the one who loved him. And the one who would be there for him. Abba, Father, everything is possible for you. Where do you go to in your time of crisis? I lost my father at the age of 14. And I know what it is not to have a father when, an earthly father, when you're going through times of crisis. Jesus just ran into the arms of Abba. That love. For the Jews, this would have been sacrilegious. This loving, warm, embracing Father. The picture of the waiting father with the prodigal son comes to mind again. Who embraces the son smelling of the pigsty. And even though he has rejected him and abandoned him, he just welcomes him back home. This is the Father we have. This is whose you are. And therefore Paul picks up on this. And only on two other occasions in Scripture is the word Abba used, and Paul uses it in Romans chapter 8 and verse 15. He says, the Spirit you receive does not make you slaves so that you will live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about you adoption to sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. And then in Galatians 4:6, he underlines this again, because you are his sons and daughters. God sent his Spirit of his Son into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. Daddy, the one who loves us. The one who says, you are my son and you are my daughter. And even though you are not yet perfect, and even though I have not yet completed my work of sanctification in you, you are the one because of my son in whom I am well pleased. This is who our Father is. It's so amazing that even after Jesus' death, the very first lesson he teaches to someone is this. You'll recall that after Jesus rose from the dead, that Mary had gone to the garden tomb to embalm the body and just to be near her master. And she discovers the tomb empty, the stone is rolled away. And then Jesus encounters her in the garden there. And notice what Jesus says to her in John chapter 20 and verse 17. Jesus said, do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Notice Father comes out there again. Go instead to my brothers and tell them. Now let's stop there. He is saying to Mary, I have a very important message you need to take to my brothers. The very first message that Jesus is going to speak to the disciples. What was that message? What did he say to Mary? What must she tell them? He says, go and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father. Isn't that awesome? My God and your God. What does Jesus say? You need to know God as Father. Because your God is my God and my Father is your Father. And I am going to him. Woo! Isn't that amazing? The very first thing Jesus tells her to tell the disciples I'm going to the Father, your Father. I'm looking forward to seeing my earthly Father in heaven. Because I missed his embraces and his words of affirmation. But more than that, I'm looking forward to seeing my heavenly Father. Because he's been there every moment of my life. And he loves me in spite of all my failings and all my sins. And that is amazing. And I know that the heart of Jesus this morning, the heart of Father God, is that you would know him as a loving Father. He cannot love us anymore. He cannot love us any less. It's never about what we do and what we don't do. He loves us in spite of who we are. And if we can learn the secret of living from that place. And so when you go to the office tomorrow morning and the boss chews you out and tells you what a no good, hopeless so-and-so you are, you say, yeah, but I know who the one who is far more important than you thinks of me. When your wife puts you down, or your husband, or the evil one comes and challenges your identity, do you really think you're a Christian? Do you really think you are a son or a daughter of God? We are able to come back to what Jesus did and to stand on the truth. When he was tempted in the desert, he simply responded, "It is written." What was he doing? He was standing on the truth. When the devil came and said, "If you are the Son of God," Jesus stopped him and said, "My Father in heaven has said, I am his son, and I stand on that reality." How much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who are his sons and daughters? What are you needing? Come boldly. Come boldly before the throne of grace to receive the mercy that we so desperately. I really do believe in this age that we need to stand on the truth of who we are. Co-heirs with Jesus. Do you know what that means? You know what it means to be a co-heir? That everything that Jesus is entitled to, we are entitled to. That blows my mind. And whose we are. Father, who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can imagine. That's who our Daddy is. Let's bow our heads, close our eyes. Let's take a moment, just a moment of quiet reflection, just to allow Holy Spirit to, just to root this message in our hearts this morning. You need to just be praying for a new revelation of who your heavenly Father is. Just say, Father, just open my eyes, open my ears, open my heart, just to discover who you are, to see you in your fullness and your glory. And maybe there have been things that you've desired to ask of God, but you just not felt worthy, and you've just felt like he's not approachable. Won't you just come? Just come. God, Jesus said this kingdom of God, we need to come as children, as little ones, to a loving Father. Won't you come as a child this morning? Just lay your heart's desires
your deepest needs before a loving Father. You're not yet a believer. You are a child of God in as much as Father God has created you, but you're not adopted as a son and a daughter, and you don't have the blessings and the privileges and the rights that an adopted son and daughter has. But you, as you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and as you ask Him to forgive you of your sins, and you seek to follow Him, so we are born again by the blood of Jesus, and we are brought into the family of God. If that's your desire, I would love to just share with you after the service how you can experience that as well. So, Valley Church, as we go into this week, may we know that we go with Father. May we know that we go as sons and daughters of the living God, that we are loved, that God is pleased with us. May we live and walk in that reality, and that in our moments of crisis we can cry out, Abba, Abba, Father, help us, help me. And He is there. So Lord, we thank You for Your word. Lord, as we enjoy some fellowship after the service around some tea and coffee, may You bless that time. And Lord, as we go into this week, may we just go into the wonderful blessing of this reality. All God's people said, Amen and Amen.